to the scriptures in an extra fun way. We want to especially welcome our members who are live at the Andrews Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church in Sanctuary. We also want to welcome our viewers and members who are viewing us on the East Jamaica Conference Virtual Church YouTube channel, as well as the Andrews Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church's YouTube channel. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for making provisions for us. Thank you for always being there with us. And I pray that as we go through this series, as we go through these programs, as we seek to change and modify the way that we live our lives, that we will see you even more clearly, and that others will see the difference in us, and that we will be more energized to represent you as we go out every day. Be with this evening's proceedings, and let your name and your name only be glorified. Amen. All right, brothers and sisters, so I'm going to invite you to stand with me as we do the AY ideals. We will first do the AY aim, the Advent message to all the world in my generation, the AY motto, the love of Christ constrains me, and the pledge, loving the Lord Jesus, I promise to take an active part in the youth ministry of the church, doing what I can to help others and to finish the work of the gospel in all the world. And know the AY song. Adventist youth are we, from every land and sea. Together we pray and work and play in happy harmony. We have a faith to share with others everywhere. A message of God from God above to show the world we care. Adventist youth, Adventist youth, Adventist youth. You may be seated. This evening, we are privileged to have a friend all the way from cool Manchester. Well, I'm not sure if Manchester is cool right now, but I'm going to still say cool, cool Manchester. Dejean Gooden will give us special music. Do enjoy.
The precious blood that flows from Calvary can make a sinner holy. Come wash me clean till every part of me is yours, Lord, and yours only. It's been so long since I felt Jesus. Just once again, I long to feel His presence. I want to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. I need a cleansing from the fountain.
My soul is hungry.
My soul is hungry. I've got this aching within. When far away from you, my heart would catch a glimpse of Calvary, remembering nights down on my knees in prayer. I say, Lord, here I am, please use me. A fool was I to ever leave you. Please take me now. Oh God, I know I need you. I want to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. I need a cleansing from the fountain.
My soul is hungry.
My soul is hungry. I've got this aching within. I want to be aching within. I want to be one.
Praise the name of the Lord. I want to be washed. That was amazing. Thank you so much, Sister Gooden. I just want to shout out to Sister Glennis in the chat at Andrews Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church. I also want to recognize Ralston Amos, Pauline C., Erica Hendricks, Soulful Sunday, Roxana Nelson Smith. Welcome. We are enjoying having you all sharing in this program with us this afternoon. And so as I led on, this evening is going to be a celebration of our beautiful minds as we delve into the Holy Scriptures in a fun way. This evening we are celebrating episode 3 of Bible Jeopardy, all of that juicy Bible drama. I want to say a special good evening to Elder Cecile Cooper, if you're watching Sister Cooper, who would have been our 2-time Bible Jeopardy champion. I also want to say a special good evening to our past contestants, namely Brother Matthew White, Brother Asa Ricketts, Pastor Duane Blake, also Elders Kwame Thomas, and Elder Wyatt Smythe. I was looking to have an elder this evening, but a number of them chickened out. They were afraid of the young people. And so, elders, if you're watching, I'm challenging you to offer yourselves for the next Bible Jeopardy to go up against the young people. So this evening, we have 3 young contestants. Firstly, we have Brother Von Dane Wade. Brother Von Dane Wade teaches in our division, and we're very pleased with Brother Von Dane Wade. Come on up, Brother Von Dane Wade, so everyone can see you. Yes, give him a round of applause. We also have Sister Kristen Giles. Sister Kristen Giles is a teacher and an insurance practitioner and active member of the youth, the young adult Sabbath school class. Give her a hand. She's the only female this evening. And finally, we have Brother Chip Sutherland, a final year dentistry student. You would know the name Chip because Chip has hosted a number of our game shows. But this evening, Chip is crossing over on the other side to show us that he has more talents. He's gonna be a contestant, and if you ask him, he'll say, I'm all that and a bag of chips. It's gonna be a fantastic evening. I'm feeling it and I'm excited. So contestants, without further ado, viewers, without further ado, I'm going to explain to you the rules of the game. You will get the opportunity to choose a category. Once you have chosen your category, I will read it for you. Once I've finished reading the statement or the question, the first person who activates their buzzer, and I'm going to ask all of you to check your buzzers to make sure they're working, just tap the red button. That's not, did your own work, Von Dane? Okay, great. And Sister Kamoya Little will be watching to determine who pressed their buzzer first. Once you have pressed your buzzer, you have 15 seconds to answer the question. If you're unable to answer the question correctly, then the other 2 contestants will get an opportunity, an equal time to answer the question. Are we clear, contestants? Wonderful. I also have to tell you, don't use your phones, and you're not allowed to take any promptings from members in the congregation who may want to help. Zip it, Sister Tanya. For persons who are in the chat, please feel free to play along. If you know the answer, to put it in the YouTube chat, and let's have fun together. And so without any further ado, are we going to bring up the screen on the system in front? So while we are waiting for our game board to come up, I would just want to hear from our contestants how you feel about this evening. Chip, how are you feeling?
Oh, me? Hi, happy Sabbath, everyone. Again, as Travine said, chips, a whole bag of chips and all these things. Long-time viewer, first-time participant, just excited that I'm sharing the stage with these amazing people, you know?
Amen.
So, let's see how it goes.
Chris, what about you?
Well, first experience on a game show. So I'm a little nervous, but excited at the same time.
Girl power. We're rooting for you, Chris. Brother Bondane, how are you feeling?
Happy Sabbath, everyone. I am excited to play.
Excited to play. Yeah. Awesome. All right, so while we wait to have it on our big screen, we will start our game. And so the categories in round one are as follows: firstborn children, lastborn children, miracles of Jesus, pools, seas, and rivers, and finally, spices. I'll read that again. Categories are as follows: firstborn children, lastborn children, miracles of Jesus, pools, seas, and rivers, and spices. I'll do give the honor to Brother Chip Sutherland as our former game show host. Sir, you have the opportunity to get the game started.
All right, I'll take firstborn children for 100, please.
All right, playing it safe. God placed a mark on me and promised vengeance sevenfold on any man who would dare slay me. Who am I? Go ahead, Brother Chip.
Who is Cain?
You are indeed correct. Please reveal the answer. We can give him a clap. Go again, Brother Chip.
All right. Can I get firstborn children for 200?
First among Moses' siblings. Go ahead, Brother Chip.
Who is Aaron?
You are indeed correct. Please reveal the answer. Chip, you may select again, and anyone who presses the buzzer first can answer the question.
Okay. Can I get firstborn children for 300?
In Genesis chapter 19, Lot was drugged to impregnate his daughters. What was the name of the firstborn son of his firstborn daughter? And I have a hint for you. He was the father of Ruth's homeland. He was the father of Ruth's homeland. Let me ask the congregation, does anybody know the answer to this question? The father of Ruth's homeland. No. Let me break it down a different way then. Where was Ruth from? Moab. And if you read the book of Genesis chapter 19, it will say that Lot's firstborn son was called Moab because he was the father of Moab. All right, give yourselves a hand. We're going to ask Sister Kristen to select.
All right, I'll take lastborn children 100.
Lastborn children for 100. And it reads, we are the first sons of Leah and Rachel. Who are we? Chip?
That would be, who is Reuben and Joseph?
You are indeed correct, Chip. Reveal the answer, please. Clap him, come on. Chip, go again.
All right, can I get firstborn children for 400?
All right. I am the firstborn son of Salmon and Rahab. Who am I? Yes, Chip.
Who is Boaz?
You are correct, Chip. Please reveal the answer. Chip, on to you again.
All right, can I get lastborn children for 200?
The youngest son of Jesse. Chip?
All right, who is David?
You are correct, Chip. Go again, Chip.
Can I get last born children, 300?
Corn, money, and the Egyptian silver cup was placed. All right, Kristen, I'll just finish reading it. Placed in the sack of the youngest son. Who was he?
Who is Benjamin?
You are indeed correct. Kristen is on the board. Go again, Chris.
I'll take last born children, 400.
All right. Twins ran in Joseph's family. His father Jacob was a twin and his sons were twins. What was the name of Joseph's last born twin son? Go ahead.
Who is Ephraim?
You are incorrect. You may go, Chris.
Who is Ephraim and Manasseh?
Who was, you're incorrect, Chris, because it's one answer we're looking for. Congregants, what do you think? Should we give Chris the answer since she called the name? But we're looking for the last born son. So really the correct answer was who was Manasseh and not who was Manasseh and Ephraim, since Manasseh was the... But I think we can give it to Kristen. Yes, brothers and sisters, she did well. She came up with the right name. All right, Kristen, back to you.
Okay, I'll take Miracles of Jesus for 100.
I was 12 when I died. People laughed at Jesus when he said that I was only sleeping before he brought me back to life. Who am I? Yes, Chip.
Who is Lazarus?
You are incorrect, Chip. Any of the congregants have the answer? You are correct, Sister Tanya Warmington. Please reveal the answer. Oh, it was Sister Little. I am very sorry. Mundane, please select your category.
Can I get Pool Season Reverse for 100?
Another name for the salt sea.
The.
Use the buzzer if you know the answer.
Dead Sea?
You are correct. Let us clap Vondane, he's on the board. What is the Dead Sea is correct. Go again, Vondane.
Can I get Pool Season Reverse for 200, please?
A man who was born blind was told by Jesus to go and wash in this pool, and afterwards his sight was restored. What was the name of this pool? Yes, Chip.
What is Salem?
What is?
Oh,
you are incorrect, Chip.
What is Siloam?
You are correct, Vondane. What is Siloam? Answer. Go again, Vondane.
Can I get Pool, Seas, and Rivers for 300?
A man who had been blind for 37 years was sitting at the name of this pool. This is translated in English as having five porches until Jesus told him to take up his bed and walk. What was the name of the pool? Brother Ransford, put down your hand. Go, Chip.
What is Bethsaida?
We'll accept it. What is Bethesda? You. Yes. Chip?
All right. Can I get Pool, Seas, and Rivers for 400?
All right. Before Elijah caught his flight on a fiery chariot, this river was separated to allow him and Elijah to cross on dry land. Chip?
What is the... Red Sea?
You are incorrect, Chip. Yes, Kristen.
What is the River Euphrates?
You are incorrect, Chris. Vondane? All right. Anyone from the congregation? Brother Ransford, what is the Jordan River? Indeed. What is the Jordan River? That was the last river they crossed before Elijah went on the fiery chariot. Vondane?
Can I get Miracles of Jesus for 300?
We did 300 or the lady with the issue of blood who touched the hem of Jesus' garment. Go ahead, Chris.
What is 12 years?
You are correct, Kristen. Welcome back to the game, Chris. Select.
Miracles of Jesus for 200.
Our wedding was at this place when Jesus brewed the best wine ever. Yes, Chris.
Where is Cana?
You are correct. Please reveal the answer. Where is Cana? Select again, Kristen.
Okay, I'll take spices for 100.
What were the spices that the shepherds brought to honor the birth of King Jesus? Yes, Chris.
What is frankincense, myrrh, and gold?
You are correct, Chris. Frankincense and myrrh. Go again, Kristen.
Okay, I'll take miracles of Jesus for 400.
Jesus restored the ear of the high priest's servant after Simon Peter and his exuberance chopped it off. What was his servant's name? Kristen?
Who is Malchus?
You are indeed correct. Who is Malchus? Let's go, Chris.
Okay, spices 200.
It is said in Numbers 11, verse 7, that this special food from heaven was as coriander seeds. Go, Chris.
What is manna?
You are correct. Select, please, Chris.
Spices 300.
The names of the three women who visited Jesus' tomb to anoint his body with spices. The names of the three women. So I'm going to turn to my congregants. Who are the women that you know? Brother Kevin. Mary, the mother of Jesus. Martha wasn't there. Mary Magdalene, and the third woman. No, there's no half points. There's a lady called Salome. Yes, so Salome, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Mary Magdalene were the three women who visited Jesus' tomb. All right, brothers and sisters. I'm going to ask Chip to select the last one. Well,
spices for 400.
The spice perfume that anointed Jesus' feet. Vondale?
Myrrh.
That is incorrect.
What is the alabaster box?
You are indeed correct, Kristen. Thank you so much. You have done well, and we are rapidly going to round two. And the categories for round two are as follows. 1, spoilers. 2, disciples. 3, crucifixion. 4, last words, and 5, visual impairment. Spoilers, disciples, crucifixion, last words, and visual impairment. Kristen, since you answered the last question correctly, you get to choose.
I'll take spoilers 100.
I used my charm and brought the strongest man in the Bible to his knees. Vondane?
Delilah.
You are indeed correct. Go again, Vondane.
Spoilers for 200, please.
Immediately after Naaman's miraculous recovery, I contracted leprosy because of my greed and lies. Time? Any, Brother Kevin? You are right. It was Gehazi. Please reveal the answer. Excellent. Sister Chris?
Spoilers 300.
I hung myself in a field of blood. Von Dane.
Who is Judas?
You are correct. Please reveal the answer. Go again, Von Dane.
Can I get the crucifixion for 100, please?
Which person assisted Jesus to carry his physical cross? Chip.
Who is Simeon?
You are incorrect. Von Dane?
Simon.
Which Simon?
Of Cyprus?
Simon, well, you're kind of close. Can we give it to him? What do you say, brothers? Yeah? Simon of Cyrene. Simon of Cyrene.
Yes.
Go again, Von Dane. The members are on your side.
Crucifixion for 200, please.
What was ripped while Jesus hung on the cross? Yes, Kristen.
What is the veil of the temple?
You are correct. Please reveal the answer. Let's go, Kristen.
I'll take disciples for 100.
I was known as a doubting disciple. Von Dane?
Who is Thomas?
You are correct. Please reveal the answer. Go again, Von Dane.
Can I get crucifixion for 300, please?
What beverage was Jesus given to drink? Von Dane?
Vinegar?
You are correct. Von Dane?
Let's finish it off with crucifixion for 400.
When given the choice, which notorious prisoners released did the mob?
Who is Barabbas?
You are indeed correct. Von Dane?
Can I get spoilers of 400, please?
One of us squashed our child through the night and planted a dead child beside the other. We went to the arbiter to judge between us. Who was this judge, Kristen?
Who is Solomon?
You are correct. Go, Kristen.
Take disciples 200.
We were known as the Sons of Thunder. Ship.
Who is James and John?
You are correct. Chip, select the next category.
Disciples 300.
I was a tax collector and hosted a dinner for Jesus, his disciples, and other tax collectors at my manor. Who am I, Chip?
Who is Matthew?
You are correct. Next category, Chip.
Disciples 4.
I was a replacement disciple for Judas.
Who is Matthias?
We'll accept it. Who is Matthias? Let's give Chip a hand. Last four answers. Chip provided them. Chip,
all right.
The next category.
Last words, 100.
Before my death, I told my son, lo, I die in my grave, which I have digged for me in the land of Canaan. There shall thou bury me. Who am I?
Who is Moses?
That is incorrect. Kristen?
Who is Jacob?
You are correct, Kristen. Please reveal the answer. Kristen, next category.
I'll take last words, 200.
Ye therefore, beloved, seeing you know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory now and forever. Who said these words?
Who is Peter?
You are correct, Chip. Excellent. Next category, Chip.
Last words, 300.
This is the interpretation of each word, mene. God has numbered your kingdom and you finished it. Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. Perez, your kingdom has been divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Who received these words, Kristen?
Who is King Darius?
You're incorrect. Anyone else? Have 15 seconds gone, my timekeeper? Chip?
Who is Darius?
You're incorrect. Congregation, Belshazzar, indeed. Who is Belshazzar? Von Dane?
Get last words for 400.
And upon a set day, blank, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of a God and not of a man. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him, because he gave not God the glory, and he was eaten up of worms and gave up his ghost. Who is this text referring to? Who is blank, who was arrayed in royal apparel? I think 15 seconds has gone. Congregants, who is this text talking about? Do we remember when Simon Peter was released by an angel in the night and somebody was upset about it and went out arrayed in royal apparel? Who was that? Who is Herod? Herod was struck by an angel when he was out showing off himself and eaten by worms, bonding. Next category.
Can I get what? I don't answer the category.
The visual impairment.
Yeah, right. Can I get it for 100, please?
Visual impairment. I was blinded by a light from heaven, and after 3 days, Ananias was sent to restore my sight. Kristen.
Who is Paul?
You are correct. Who is Saul / Paul? Kristen, select the next category.
Visual impairment, 200.
Jesus made a paste to cover a blind man's eyes before restoring his sight. I believe it was Von Dane, okay? What was in this concoction?
Spittle and mud.
Absolutely. Reveal the answer, please. What is saliva and soil? Same answer. Thank you, Von Dane.
Can I get visual impairment for 300?
Outside of Saul, I'm probably the only blind person whose name was specifically mentioned in the Bible. Who am I? Kristen.
Who is Ananias?
Incorrect. Chip?
Who is Isaac?
Incorrect, but that's a good answer. That's right, Sister Tanya. Who is blind Bartimaeus? But I must concede that Chip did give a good answer a while ago, because Isaac was blind at some point, yes? So that was a good answer. That was a good answer. I think, Chip, you can get the point, because that was a good answer. Final one. My love stick stupidity resulted in me betraying my Nazareth vow and losing my eyes. Who am I, Kristen?
Who is Samson?
Correct. Let's give our contestants a big hand and our congregants who have been helpful. We're going to have another song from Sister Gooden and give them an opportunity to rest up for round 3 and a bonus round. Sister Gooden.
Reaching out with no one to hold, you've been abandoned with no place to go, wounded and wanting such desperate times. Cold bitter tears are filling your eyes, so get a glimpse of Jesus, for he is right there with you. He knows just what you need. 'Cause when life gets broken and you're in despair, he'll carry your burdens when it's too much to bear. It's down in the valley where he'll give you strength. There is nothing you have lost that God can't replace. He'll help you start all over again when life gets broken. You hoped God would heal it, but the storm raged and raged. Now it's hard to imagine how you made it through the day. Weeks turned to years, time's passing you by, but you're still holding on to the hows and the whys. So get a glimpse of Jesus, for he is right there with you. He knows just what you need. 'Cause when life gets broken and you're in despair, he'll carry your burdens when it's too much to bear. It's down in the valley where he'll give you strength. There is nothing you have lost that God can't replace. He'll help you start all over again when life gets broken. Healing waters heal our troubled souls. Oh, Jesus, sweet Jesus, will cleanse and make us whole. Broken when life gets broken.
Amen. We have truly been blessed by Sister Gooden's ministry this evening. How to you, brothers and sisters? It's been so spirit-filled. Fantastic. So, in our chat, Kristen, Von Dane, and Chip, you have some fans who are rooting for you. We have some persons in the chat who have been actively playing along, and I just want to recognize some of you. We have Divinely Anointed on EJC's platform. We have Colette Bartley, very humorously, when we asked the question, who assisted Jesus with carrying the cross, her response was a black man. We also have Divinely Anointed, who is playing along. Precious Violet is your big fan, Kristen. She keeps on saying, come on, Chris. Chris is coming back strong. We have, who else do we have here? We have Velma Bryce Rose, who is saying, go Chip. That's your fan, Chip. So you need to look up Velma Bryce Rose. We also have Naomi Caesar, who is playing along. We have Rochelle Wilson. We have Naomi Caesar, Nick Kay. We have Glennis from Andrews playing along as well. C. Brown from Andrews playing along as well. We really appreciate you brothers and sisters joining in on the fun. And so now we are progressing very quickly to round three. So we only have one amendment to the rules. This time we can lose points if we answer incorrectly. And so I would love for our contestants to think very carefully as they answer. It's all in good fun. But if you answer incorrectly, then you're going to lose the amount of points that were in your category. And so now we move very quickly to round three. I hear someone saying they're rooting for Vondane. There you go, Vondane. All right, so the categories for round three are as follows. Friends, House, Game of Thrones, Suits, and The Good Wife. Friends, House, Game of Thrones, Suits, and The Good Wife. Vondane, we'll start with you.
Can we start with House for 100, please?
House for 100. Which three individuals lived in the house Jesus frequented in Bethany? Kristen.
Who are Mary, Martha, and Lazarus?
You are correct, Kristen. Select again, Kristen.
Friends for 100.
Which wealthy friend provided a sepulcher for Jesus' body? Go, Chris.
Who is Joseph of Arimathea?
You are correct, Kristen. Please select the next category.
Friends for 200.
Which influential Pharisee first met Jesus at night? It was a nocturnal meeting. Congregation. Which influential Pharisee? It was Nicodemus indeed. Contestants, you knew that answer. Didn't you know it? Chip, select the next category.
All right, can I get Game of Thrones 100?
While sitting in the judgment seat, I ignored my wife's warning to leave the innocent man alone. Vondane.
Who is Pilate?
You are correct. Please select the next category.
Game of Thrones 200.
I used my teenage daughter as a pawn to mesmerize my husband and eliminate John the Baptist. Kristen, you buzz first.
Who is Herodias?
You are correct, Kristen. Please select the next category.
Friends 300.
Who are Paul's tent maker friends? Go again, Chris.
Who are Aquila and Priscilla?
You are correct, Kristen. Please select the next category.
Friends 400.
Who was a commander in chief of King Saul's army? Go, Chris.
Who is David?
You are incorrect. Anyone else? Who was King Saul's right-hand man? Who was his commander-in-chief? Congregants. No, Joab was King David's right-hand man. Who was King Saul's right-hand man? Who was his ride or die? Anyone? A man called Abner. Who is Abner? Vondane, next category.
Can I get House for 200?
200 for House? Whose home was Simon Peter visiting when he received the dream of the unclean meats? Chip.
Who is Cornelius?
You're incorrect. Whose home was Simon Peter visiting when he received the dream? Congregants, who was Simon Peter visiting? Not Cornelius, it was Cornelius who he went to minister to, but whose home was he staying at when he received the vision? Who? Ananias? No, Sister Little. Someone who bears his name, Simon the Tanner. Chip, next category. But you had the right story, Chip. We give you that. You had the right story, but the wrong house.
All right. Give me suits for 100.
The first suit of clothing was made from? Kristen.
What is fig leaves?
You are correct, Kristen. I get the impression the claps are waning. Why is that so? Thank you very much. Kristen, next category.
The Good Wife, 100.
Without the benefit of any legal paperwork, I unilaterally selected a surrogate from our servants to bear my husband's first child because I wanted to help fulfill the prophecy. Adrian, who first? Vondane?
Who is
Kristen.
Sarah?
Sorry, Vondane. Kristen? Who? You saw Kristen first. I have to yield to the judge. Kristen?
Who is Sarah?
You are correct, Kristen. Next category.
The Good Wife, 200.
I offered a night with her husband to his first wife in exchange for the mandrakes her son reaped to help my fertility. Who am I? Kristen?
Who is Leah?
You're incorrect. Right story. Chip?
Who is Rachel?
You are correct, Chip. Right. Chip?
Can I get suits of 200?
John the Baptist's suit of clothing was made from? Kristen.
What is camel's hair?
You are correct. Kristen.
The Good Wife, 300.
I intervened to preserve my husband's life by circumcising our son. Congregants, Zipporah, yes, Brother Kevin. Brother Kevin, you should be on the next show. Indeed, when Moses was on his way to Egypt and Zipporah circumcised her son and she shouted at Moses, you are a bloody man. Bondane, next category.
Can I get house for 300?
House for 300. Whose home did the widows frequent in Joppa for assistance? Contestants? Congregants? Dorcas. Vondane, go again.
Game of Thrones for 300.
In exalting myself above God, I was rapidly transformed into a beast of the field, driven from my throne and grazed like an ox. Chip.
Who is Nebuchadnezzar II?
Excellent. You are correct, Chip. Next category, Chip.
Can I get Game of Thrones 400?
Had I been born a girl, they could have called me Rapunzel. My hair contributed to my capture after I tried to steal my father's throne, Chip.
Who is... who is Abigail?
Kristen?
Who is Absalom?
You are correct, Kristen. Next category, Kristen.
The good wife, 400.
I saved my husband from going down in history as a king who exterminated an entire race. Chip.
Who is Esther?
You are correct, Chip. Next category, Chip.
All right, let's have suits of 300.
In your own words, Luke 3 verse 11 tells us that if you have two coats, what should you do? What should you do if you have two coats? Yes, Kristen.
You should give them away.
You're correct, Kristen. Giving it to others who don't have clothes. Indeed. Let's give her a clap. Next category.
House 400.
And Jesus said unto him, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath blank to lay his head. Chip?
No place.
You are correct, Chip. Chip, you take the final question on the board.
Suits 400.
Matthew 7 verse 15, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening. Kristen?
What are wolves?
You are correct, Kristen. Game well played. May we have an indication of the point standing before we enter into our bonus round? Just give us a minute to bring up the scores. And so the current point standing is Chip, 900, Kristen, 1600, and Vondane, 100. There's something, has to be something wrong right there. Yes. Yes. Okay. All right. So we have it for each round. All right. So we had a little issue there. So for round one, it was Vondane at 100, Kristen at 1500, and am I looking at the last one? All right. So we have Vondane at 300, Kristen at 2300, and Chip at 1300.
That's overall.
That's round one. All right. So can we get our judges to properly tally before they launch an inquiry against me? Our public is anxiously waiting to hear what is the status. How much longer, judges? We have three judges and a math problem. So while we wait, contestants, which question was particularly interesting for you? Which one did you know and you never answered correctly? Kristen? Which one was a giveaway and you completely messed it up?
Well, for me, I think the biggest giveaway was the question for blind Bartimaeus.
Yes. But Chip did give a good response because Isaac was said to have been blind or his vision was dim. The Nebuchadnezzar one, yes? Who went out into the field. What about you, Chip? The Belshazzar one. Yes, that was one. All right, so I think we have it here. We have Von Dane at 1900. We have Chip at 3600. And we have the only female in the race at 5100, Kristen. Well done, well done. And so now we're entering into our bonus round. You'll notice that you have paper and you have pen. And you will not be turning over your cell phones. You'll not be looking at audience members for any help. So ignore Sister Tanya and Brother Kevin and all of those very helpful people, those who don't have one. Yes, please. So the bonus question is as follows. King Saul was upset that David received assistance, and by assistance we mean holy bread and the sword of Goliath from the high priest Ahimelech in Nob. He ordered his soldiers to kill the priests, and they all refused except one man. Who was this man who killed 85 priests in one day? I'm going to read it again. King Saul was upset that David had received help, that is the holy bread and the sword of Goliath, from the high priest Ahimelech. He ordered his soldiers to kill the priests, and they all refused except one man. Who was this man that killed 85 priests in one day? If you know the answer, please scribble it down and let us know how much you're willing to give up or not. Contestants, let's hear from you, Von Dane.
What you hear from me is that I am willing to bid $0 because I do not know the answer to this question.
Von Dane is keeping his 1900 points. Kristen in the lead. Did you write anything on your paper?
No, I'm staying put.
Kristen is holding her position of 5,100.
It's like an easy choice.
Brother Chip.
So I happen to scribble.
Yes.
Who is question mark? And I wagered what, 1 point?
All right. So that means that our contestants are not with that question. I do see the answer in our EJC virtual chat. I don't know if these persons Googled or if they actually know. Denny Starlove and Joey, you have the correct answer. I'd love to know if you did any Google searches or if you actually knew this question. I'm going to ask one of our contestants to read for us 1 Kings chapter 22 and verse 18. You can use your phone now. First Kings chapter 22 and verse 18, where you will find the answer. Yes.
First Kings chapter 22 verse 18 says, "And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, Did I not tell thee that he would prophesy no good concerning me but evil?" Continue.
I think I gave you the wrong text. I apologize. Let me pick that up. First Kings chapter 22. First Samuel, yes. First Samuel verse 22.
Oh, 1 Samuel 22, verse 18. "And the king said to Doeg, Turn thou and fall upon the priests. And Doeg the Edomite turned, and he fell upon the priests, and slew on that day 85 persons that did wear a linen ephod."
It was a dark day for one man to kill 85 men of God. Brothers and sisters, I think we want to give a round of applause to our contestants for a job well done this evening. Would you agree? Were you reminded about your Bible? Did you learn something new today? You learned who was Doeg. And were you encouraged to go back and read your Bible and catch up on some of these stories and things you might have forgotten? You knew it once and you forgot it. That was the point, to make us fall in love with the Bible once again. I see you, Sister Carolissa Nugent, and others on the Andrews Memorial YouTube chat sharing your answers. We appreciate it. So, congregants, before we close off our AY, I thought maybe I'd just throw a few questions on you about children. Contestants, you can relax and join the congregation. Clap them again. Is there anyone who could name the 12 sons of Jacob, or name some of them? You could name, just name the sons of Jacob. Anyone that you can remember? Benjamin, Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Dan, Naphtali, Zebulun, yes, Joseph. How could we forget Joseph, Shante? Who else? Issachar, and finally, Benjamin. Yes. What about Lamech? Who is Lamech's son? Methuselah? Who is Lamech's son? Son of Lamech. Brother Kevin? Lamech's son was Noah. How about Noah's sons? Shem, Ham, and Japheth. What about Abraham? Abraham's son. Isaac, and who else? And Ishmael. And there were others. And there were others. What about Isaac? Esau and Jacob. Does anybody know any of the wives of Esau? You can use your phones. Any of the wives of Esau? Titania? No. There was one named Judith. Yeah, a popular name, Judith. Does anybody know who was the son of Ruth and Boaz? Obed, yes. And who was Obed's son? Jesse. And Jesse's son, one of Jesse's sons was David, and a host of other brothers, yes. You see how the Bible is connected? And you see how very interesting it is? And so we are definitely encouraging our members to study, to show yourselves approved. We'll be having more Jeopardy games, and we're inviting persons who think they want to engage in these kind of activities to help your brain and help your spirituality to volunteer, and we're very happy to showcase you. I want to thank you for your contributions this evening, and I'm going to ask Sister Gooden to come and share her final song before we transition into our evening program.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for families, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for God's mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each broken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. So what if your blessing come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know God's near? And what if trials of this life are God's mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, His voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel God here. We doubt His goodness and we doubt His love, as if every promise from God's word is not enough. And all the while, He hears your spoken need, and long that we have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessing come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know God's near? And what if trials of this life are God's mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds our heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. 'Cause what if your come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know God's near? What if the greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can satisfied? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storm, your sleepless nights are God's mercies in disguise. Oh, oh.
It was indeed beautiful. We are about to transition into our evening service. But to set the tone, we are going to engage in a season of praise and worship because God has been very good to us, hasn't he, brothers and sisters? And so we have some of our young people who are going to lead out in some praise and worship. Sister Adrian, Sister Kamoya, and Brother Adrian, they're going to lead us to put us in that special zone so that when the word of God hits, it will find lodgement in hearts that were very well prepared. Thank you so much for being a part of AY. And now we move into our second segment immediately. May God bless you richly.
So we're going to be doing a few hymns. We'll begin with hymn 373, Seeking the Lost.
Wanderers on the mountainous trail, come to me.
151, He lives. It's a bit too high for us.
How charming is the Christian soul. Thank you.
The actions, just in case I get mixed up, but let's go. Love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply strained within, sinking to rise no more.
Very deeply stained within, sing.
continue with song with Watch Ye Saints 5:9-8.
Watch Ye Saints with eyelids waking, know the course of heaven are shaking. Keep your lamps all trimmed and burning, ready for the Lord's returning. Though He comes, Lord Jesus comes. Though He comes, He comes all glorious. Jesus comes to reign victorious. Though He comes, yes, Jesus comes. Though the promise of your Savior pardon sin and purchase favor, blood washed robes and crowns of glory,
the battle cry.
Sound the battle cry, see the foe is nigh, raise the standard high for the Lord. Gird your arms, strong to meet the foe, marching on we go, while our cause we know must prevail. Shield and banner bright, gleaming in the light, advancing for the right, we ne'er can fail. Rouse and soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud hosannas,
again, everyone. And happy Sabbath. So we'll start Vespers with prayer. Please stand. Dear kind and compassionate Father, thank you for allowing us to spend another Sabbath in your courts. Thank you for today and all the blessings that we received. Please be with this evening's Vespers service. Help that it will be a blessing to us and all our viewers online. Please be with the speaker. Help that he will speak the words from you. And anything we fail to ask, grant it. Amen. You may be seated.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Thank you. Now, firstly, I would like to thank the praise team for that beautiful singing. I was truly blessed. And, you know, for today's Vespers program, I will be your host. And for those who don't know me, my name is Asari Gates. And right next to me, I have my beautiful co-host, and her name is Kamaya. And can you please say hi?
My name is Kamoya Little.
Yes, Kamoya. Thank you, ma'am. Okay. So firstly, I just want to say welcome to everyone to the first evening session of the July Health Evangelistic Series, namely, Lord, Clothe Me in My Right Mind. These will take place on Sabbaths at 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. and every weeknight except Mondays and Fridays. Kamoya?
Okay, and for our viewers and online, as well as our members in Sanctuary, we're inviting you to share the link with your friends. We are live on EJC Virtual Church, as well as Andrew's Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church YouTube channels.
Thank you, and this is surely one series that you do not want to miss. And Kamoya, are you happy for this?
I am indeed happy for this. Congregation, are you happy for this?
You know, I'm not really somebody who is really into the series like that, but I'm excited about this one, you know, because I feel like God has a message for each and every one of us. Church, you think you're going to get deliverance? Amen. All right. At this time, I would like Kamoya to do the introduction of the speaker, after which I'll do the scripture reading. Then I'll cause a praise team to do the theme song. And the next voice you'll hear is that of our speaker. Kamoya?
Okay, so our speaker for this evening is none other than Dr. Stanley James. He's a dynamic international evangelist and a medical doctor from Bermuda. He has combined his passion for healthy patients and souls into his unique ministry, and we are blessed to have him in our church today. We pray for his ministry, and we look forward to the transformation that will be present in our church for the next 21 days.
Thank you. The scripture reading is taken from Daniel 1, verse 8 and 9. Please stand. We will read alternately. I will read first. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Here endeth the reading of God's holy word. You may be seated. At this time, I will invite the praise team to do our theme song.
Please stand and sing along with us. I bless your name.
I bless your name.
Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Psalms 42. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. O my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I will remember you from the land of the Jordan and from the height of Hermon, from the hills of Mizar. Deep calls unto deep at the noise of your waterfalls. All your waves and billows have gone over me. The Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the nighttime his song shall be with me. A prayer to God of my life. I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with breaking of my bones, my enemies reproach me, while they say to me all day long, where is your God? Depression. And we see David wrestled with that. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you disquieted within me? But he ends, hope in God. I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. Some things are difficult to talk about. Some things we avoid addressing. But often people are hurting on the inside before it shows up on the outside. People are hurting in the midst of a crowd, and they still feel lonely. I remember seeing her walk into the room, and as she sat there, her face was just a flat effect. There wasn't much emotion at all. And I tried to figure out what was going on, and it wasn't long before her cheerful, regular self, something was different. I asked her about her appetite. She wasn't much that she wanted to eat. She said she just didn't feel like eating much food. And then, of course, with a few more questions, we began to notice that not only was that the case, she wasn't sleeping very well. She had few interests in pleasurable activities. She didn't go to the park. She wasn't working out anymore. She just seemed to have just dropped off from her social net group, and church didn't do for her what it used to do before. Sleep was off, no longer interested in things. But then she started to say, my prayers seem like they just don't get through. Ruminating guilt of things in the past, she just couldn't shake it. Concentration at work was really a mess, and her relationship with her significant other really began to deteriorate. And of course, she thought, if I just pray, just pray, just pray, just pray. And then she began to think, my faith is weak, maybe it's me. And because she didn't quite understand that mood disorders, and depression in particular, have very little to do with you being a bad person. Rather, it deals with you who needs help, care, and support. And because we live in a culture of shame, who can you go to with this deep personal struggle? Where can you tell the truth about the fact that you just can't shake it? And people say, just kick it, just shake it, and you just can't will yourself out of this pit. Even David is asking God, why have you withdrawn from me? We don't just see with David, we see it throughout the Bible. There are many other characters. Elijah found himself, after such a great accomplishment on the mountain, was able to actually call down fire. And strangely enough, after that, he was running from Jezebel, finds himself there by himself in a deep slump. David, Elijah, and there are others in the Bible. There's Saul, who struggled with this. So we find that this is a part of the human experience. Depression is real. But there are some lifestyle keys that can help us in beating the blues. Not all depression is created equal. And if you suffer from depression, understand that you're not alone. Someone says, how do I know if I'm depressed or just have the blues? What type of depression is it? Much more information is available about depression. And if we begin to talk about it and share about it, we soon come to discover that we can get help and shake it and begin to turn life around. You can actually get success in this. It's not a sign that God has left you. As a matter of fact, God draws closer to people with depression. I'll say it again. God actually draws closer to people with depression because he knows that your picture of him is distorted. That you begin to see yourself as a failure and a reject and see God as a hostile judge who's withdrawn himself from you. And it's simply because your perspective is wrong. God hasn't changed. He still is committed to you. He still is seeking and saving you. He still created a plan that cannot be shaken. The cross is still the cross, a historical fact. He justified you and nobody can change that. I said he justified you, meaning that you are not his enemy. You are his child. That doesn't change. I don't care what you do. Your child can be a bad child, but it's still what? Your child. Your child could be out in the street, but it's still who? Your child. No matter what your child does, you can't unchild yourself. So when God decided to adopt us, he locked himself into a new relationship, and he did it before the fall, knowing we will fall, so that he can redeem us from the fall. Somebody ought to say amen. And so no matter what your mind is saying, look at what the word is saying, because your mind may be off, but the word is still on. Come on, somebody, that God is still committed to you no matter how you feel. But you're not alone. As a matter of fact, 20 million Americans actually suffer from depression, 3 million teens in particular. Not just that. There are people who are very significant in American history. We know that Abraham Lincoln, who says, I am now the most miserable man living. If what I feel were equally distributed to the whole human family, there would be not one cheerful face on earth. Winston Churchill, great prolific political leader, he says, battled this depression of this demon depression for many years, almost fulfilling his father's prediction of a shabby, unhappy, and futile existence. The depression didn't win. I'll say it again. Their depression didn't win. When we were created in the Garden of Eden, our neurotransmitters were working very well. What are they? You have neurons, which are like little, these long fibers in the brain that release neurotransmitters. And these are little packages that carry information from one neuron to another. There are a number of them, and four in particular. There's norepinephrine, there's serotonin, there's GABA, and there's dopamine. All of these affect us in different ways. GABA is associated with anxiety. Serotonin is associated with depression. Dopamine is also hyperactivity. And norepinephrine affects these symptoms as well. Depending upon the release of these neurotransmitters, they can affect you, your mood. Serotonin in particular is implicated in depression. If you have a decreased amount of serotonin released, and it's not enough in the between one, it's sort of like there's a bus, and there's one bus that drops the people off, and there's another one that they have to get on. If there are not enough people, there's your neurotransmitters, there's not enough momentum to get the message to the other side. So these two connections have to have enough serotonin so that you can effectively communicate to each other, and that keeps your mood balanced. The things that affect serotonin are many. And some of those things were just inborn errors of metabolism. Before the fall, we didn't have this weakness. After the fall, some of us have decreased release of that serotonin. Sometimes it's an uptake, sometimes it's a production problem. Either way, you are not at fault because your neurotransmitters are not working. But sometimes you end up feeling so shameful and so guilty that instead of getting help, you begin to harm yourself. Many factors influence the risk for and severity of depression. It is important to identify and target the ones that you can change. There are some things that you can actually change. The good news is that even when people are prone to depression, in other words, you may have it in your family line, there are many factors that are tunable and changeable. Do you know also that there are some behaviors that you get into early in life that later on in life can affect your mood and the way you perceive yourself? That God gave us certain moral laws to protect our mind and our mood. I'll say it again. God gave us instruction on living a life in certain ways to affect our mind and our mood. That many years ago, of course, God knew that devil would try to do some things to put you out of integrity and cause guilt and shame and depression to overwhelm you. As a matter of fact, when we look at Adam at the fall, the first thing he said, I am naked and I'm ashamed. Adam was experiencing some moment of depression. He was worried down because of his separation, of his connection. He couldn't see beyond this cloud. And this sense of condemnation and guilt and shame had to be dealt with at the cross. One of the things the cross is designed to do is change your perspective on the way you see yourself and the way you see God. It shifts your depression. Chronic depression risk factors include family history and genetics. You can't do anything about it. You're born with it. Certain medications and medical conditions. Some people on medications that are treating certain illnesses can actually cause them to have mood disturbances. Beta blockers is one in particular associated with heart diseases and hypertension. Social environment stressors. If you live in intense communities where there's a lot of people, or perhaps where there's a lot of pollution in the air, poor water, things you can take in that are toxins that you can take in that can affect your mood as well. Other risk factors include nutrition and lifestyle. Do you know that some of the foods that you eat do not have sufficient nutrients and vitamins to support the production of neurotransmitters so that you can effectively have a good mood? Some foods that actually designed in a way that it can actually boost your mood for a moment and then drop your mood after. And then habits of thinking. We have cognitive distortions. When Adam said, I'm naked, that was a distortion. How do I know? Because Jesus came and said, who told you that you're naked? Adam had a cognitive distortion. I'm naked. No. Who told you that you're naked? And because Adam had the wrong information, he had to get correct information to change his cognitive distortion. And many of us have information that's the wrong information. Someone may walk in the room and just walk past you like this, and you say, she doesn't like me. Who does she think she is? So she's not speaking now. Because she got her nursing degree, she's not speaking. Now you're creating a whole story. You said she doesn't like me. Who does she think she is? Must be because she just graduated. She's making some money now. And the lady didn't see you. But you've run off of a whole story. You've got a cognitive distortion. The way you're thinking has caused you to be in a negative space, and it's not true. How many people have lost relationships, gotten into conflict, and alienated themselves from people simply because of a cognitive distortion? You know, and so someone may do something to you, and you will say, someone may offend you, and you say, oh, the reason why you did that to me is because you wanted to hurt me. I've seen that a lot of times in ladies in relationships. They may have come in for counseling and said, he was jealous of me. He just didn't want me to have. And it goes wild. It has, or a man may come in and say, well, she was trying to emasculate me. She wasn't trying to emasculate you. She disrespected me. Why do you say she disrespected you? Listen to how she talked to me. She's disrespectful. She's not talking to you like that because she's disrespecting you. She's talking to you that way because she's hurt. So when she's hurt, sometimes she expresses herself in a way that lands on you as disrespect. It wasn't intended to be disrespect, but you're interpreting it as disrespect. You've got a cognitive distortion. And so we have to start thinking, are my thoughts correct? I know the fact, but how am I interpreting the fact? I know that, you know, you may say something happened at my job, I lost my job. You may say then that means that they plotted to fire me. No. I lost my job. Okay, God is angry with me. No. And we have to take captive our mind. Because we have many cognitive distortions that put us in a depression, and we are not looking at the facts. We're going based upon our feelings. Addictions. Some people are prone to be addicted to certain things. You know, I've seen people who have, I remember when I was in high school, there was some people that they were flirting with smoking marijuana. Some people did it and got past it, but others are still doing it 50 years later. Others find themselves drinking, and there's a casual drink, and they can handle it. But someone else may find themselves can't break that addiction. See, the problem is you don't know what your genetic load is. You ought not play with things that can potentially become addictive because you don't know what's lurking deep down in the thousands of years of ancestors, the weaknesses in your neurotransmitters, so you can expose yourself to some things that became a slavish pattern, that become a demonic depression, and you say, how come that person did it and they got out but I didn't? Well, you were wired entirely differently. Spiritual needs. Because we live in an empire of Western civilization, listen, because we live under the European worldview, which do teach that science is the God and gods do not really matter. We live in a worldview that says that there is no such thing as spirituality. How do I know? Because we do things that we never would have done before. We look at television programs that break down our moral fiber because somehow or the other we've learned from Greek education that there's no such thing as spiritual things and God. We think there's only science and evidence. And because we think that there's no spirituality, we expose ourselves to things that hurt us at spiritual levels because we've bought into the lie of the Western world that says spirituality doesn't exist. We're under culture clash. And hundreds of years ago in the Western world, the Europeans, the British, the French, the German, the Portuguese came and captured us. We believed in a God, and so did they. They believed in a God shaped by the Catholic Christian religion. We had different ontology and religious worldviews. But when they captured us, eventually they migrated from the Christianity of Catholicism and went into a world of the age of reason. In other words, they began to say, you know, we're in universities now, and now Greek education, we don't really think we need to talk about God and spirituality. And those that do believe in God and spirituality, you're primitive. You come from somewhere in some primitive land. Get away from that old hang up and thinking and come to the new way of modern thinking. And so we went into a cultural revolution, a religious shift, philosophical change, and we became like our oppressors. We adapted the mindset of the Westerner that says there's no such thing as spirituality and religion. And we're conflicted because you go to school and say, well, the school says that that's not real. And so you begin to have these internal conflicts and you begin to throw away your spirituality. You don't believe in your God and your religion. And you decide, well, I don't have to live according to spiritual principles, so I can listen to any type of music. I can have any type of sexual practices. I can handle my sense of the sacredness. It's not, nothing's really sacred. And you treat yourself like you're any old thing, that like there's no eternal world. There's no deeper meaningful strivings. There's no real purpose to your life. And you have an internal spiritual conflict because you're out of integrity. Does that make sense? Because we've bought into the lie of the educated centers that teach us to be like them. And you're wondering, why am I in conflict? Because your deep spiritual strivings, what you believe in, are in conflict with what you've come to know. Science is great, but it has limitations. It doesn't know everything. It has its presuppositions and its boundaries. You come and you use science as a tool, but don't let science use you as a tool. You use science as a tool, but don't let science use you as a tool. You have your core beliefs, and you must live in integrity with those beliefs. And the scriptures are your source of authority for spirituality, and let science be its authority for interpreting physical matter. Let it know its place. Always work with your healthcare provider when making medical or lifestyle changes, especially with severe depression or mood changes. Now, depression is not a light thing. It doesn't come in just one type. the variety of subtypes of depression, and some are much more severe than others. Medical providers are necessary science because there are some things that religion doesn't address. So your spirituality needs to know its place. Just because you have faith doesn't mean your faith is going to get you a serotonin, a neurotransmitter. You may need medication, you may need nutritional therapy, you may need cognitive therapy, you may need family support. You need to address it with a professional that can make a distinction between what is medical, what is emotional, what is spiritual, what is nutritional, and what is social. You need to have that level of support. Okay. Depression is an erosion of connections in your life as well as between your brain cells. I like that. Because we are built to be in community. In what? And when you're in community in healthy relationships, your mood tends to be better. When you're celebrating with optimism, music, and joy, and having relationships that are fulfilling, the neurotransmitters seem to work better. And when you're broken down from community in isolation, and we saw that with the pandemic, when you had that lockdown, and you couldn't move around, and you felt like someone was forcing something on you, it began to destroy something important inside of us. And then when we're now stuck on Zoom and locked out, we're comfortable in this abnormal space, we don't crave community and connection, and it increases the likelihood of emotional disorders, things like depression. New nerve cells are born in the brain every day in regions affected by depression. That's good news. Just because some things are struggling don't mean that's it. You know, God is always, grace is always trying to replenish and refill. Just like the water comes in and the water washes out, but trust me, the water is coming in again. Somebody ought to say amen. The sun comes up, it goes down, but the sun is coming up again. God has put some type of redemptive features in nature, in our bodies, and in our minds. And we try, the system is trying to regenerate and preserve itself if we cooperate with it. Positive lifestyle choices encourage new nerve cell growth. Did you know that if you change some of your behaviors, your nerve cells, which may have been affected negatively, can actually begin to rekindle and regenerate and re-improve? The devil would want you to think the way you feel today is the way it's going to be tomorrow. That's not true. With just a little tweaking and changing in some things, if you know how to target them, your outlook can change and you can be a better person. You can be clothed in your right mind. Somebody ought to say amen right there. If you came in here with some fear and uncertainty about your depression, if you came in with a knowledge of the fact that, you know, you've had weaknesses and struggle, I've stopped by to tell you today, what you feel is not the facts. Oh, somebody ought to say amen right there. What you feel is not the facts. And what you feel is not final. Increased connections in brain cells can also improve. Not only do you get new nerve cell growth, but you get better connections. We talked about the synapse between the axons and the dendrites before. Improved nerve cell survival. With eating right, exercising right, having right relationships and practices that are healthy, you can actually have the nerve cells that will survive. That's somebody ought to say good news. Nutrition and lifestyle. One of the biggest things you can do is start physical and mental exercise. Some of the physical exercises that we do, it's not really for our body. You know, many times I used to lift weights, and I was lifting weights because I wanted, you know, to look better. But I've discovered that lifting weights is actually for I can think and feel better. And many times when you're depressed, you pull away, you withdraw, you shut down. You don't really want to engage in physical activity. It's not the best thing to do. You want to even get outside and just take 10 steps. Do 2 or 3 push-ups. Do 1 or 2 sit-ups. And you will get up tomorrow, you do 12 steps. You will begin to see that the body has a way of regenerating itself. The curse on the earth was designed as a blessing. When God said, I'm going to make it hard for you to till the soil, that wasn't a curse to hurt Adam. He knew that the body needs to be involved with physical labor to regenerate itself, to produce neurotransmitters, to remove the depression that came with the fall. When Adam said, I'm naked and I'm condemned, that depression would be lifted as he began to work and regenerate and be involved in the very process of his survival. People that do not do physical labor and are not out in nature tend to be more depressed. So getting involved with the ground, getting involved with agriculture, getting involved with nature is actually a way of regenerating and restoring yourself. The salvation process is not a passive process. It is a process where God has justified you, yes, but in order to experience that justification, you've got to choose to obey his rules. And as you cooperate with the human, given its will, and the divine, given its power, you begin to be restored into the very image of God. You need to do something so that God can do something in you. Somebody ought to say amen. Diet and exercise encourage growth factors. Yes, proper nutrition. Someone says, what is proper nutrition? And that's a good question. There are some foods that affect your neurotransmitters and leave you depleted. If someone's looking online, I want you to know today there's a lot of resources that are available for you. And you don't have to sit there and eat the foods and think that they don't affect you. You can actually eat foods that can improve your mood. Adequate sleep. 2 hours before is actually worth more than 4 hours after midnight. It's real. And when you go to bed, the cell phone should be at a distance. The television should be off. The laptop should not be on your bed. And you go to bed, you want to go to sleep 2 hours before midnight. And you want to start doing that at a regular basis. The first thing people come back and tell me is, well, I work shift. I can't help you. I can't change that. But I can tell you is what the data shows. Did you know that the day actually begins in the dark? So when you want to start your day, God starts your day with a good rest. When you rest, you're not resting from yesterday. You're resting to prepare yourself for tomorrow. So when you go to bed with good thoughts because you're programming and priming yourself for the day that's in front of you. After all, it was in the evening when Eve was made and Adam was made. The first thing they did was, of course, after they got together and they did what they did, I'm sure they didn't wait that Friday night. Somebody ought to say amen right there. Somebody ought to say amen right there. The first thing they did, they went and they rested. They started the day at the cool of the evening. So what you want to start thinking is when you go to bed, you're preparing the mind, the unconscious mind, for the next day. If you can have a settled mind and a defined time to go to sleep, your next day will be much more peaceful. Anyone can gain cognitive clarity and emotional stability. Diet and exercise encourage growth factors that put the brakes on self-destructive cellular activity. The cells actually have things in them called antioxidants, and they have cellular repair. The cell has the ability to repair itself. It has things in it that's called for methylation. It's very complex processes. But we're discovering that these things can be slowed down if you have good nutrition, good exercise, and good sleep. The destructive patterns that we see can be slowed down. These are the same patterns we see in aging. Many people who rough themselves up in their youth do not have good nutrition, do not have good exercise, and do not have good sleep. In the older years, have deterioration in the mind. As a matter of fact, the inflammation that's associated with things like diabetes and heart disease actually are predetermining factors of something called Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is actually first shown up with people who have diabetes. Increased incidence of diabetes, increased prevalence of Alzheimer's and neurocognitive decline. The mechanism is usually associated with inflammation. As more you have more inflammation in your body, the more destructive and deleterious it is into the mind. But there's good news. Exercise, nutrition, and good sleep help to fight against the destructive influences that chronic inflammation can have on you. It also releases antioxidants. Antioxidants are responsible for fighting against things that lead to high levels of inflammation and also precursors to cancer. Provide protein building blocks for brain cells. And those protein building blocks are responsible for the neurotransmitters that are actually associated with decreasing depression and improving mood. Nutrition interventions may benefit psychiatric conditions and countless aspects of human well-being. That the food that you eat, if there's a balanced food which has plant-based whole food nutrition. What I say? Plant-based whole food. Somebody says, what do you mean by plant-based? Plant-based. Plant. I know you like
I know what you like, but I'm going with plant. And whole food. What's whole food? You know, some of them say, I got some plant-based food, but it's in a box that was in the store and it's been there for a year sitting on a shelf. That's not a whole food. You want to try to get things as close to fresh as possible. Somebody ought to say amen. Do you know that life promotes life? So if the food has life in it, it's going to feed and give life to the brain. Doesn't that make sense? Dead food is what? Dead food. That there are more to the food than just simply sugar, carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. There's actually electromagnetic influences that food has, and it affects the body and the nature in ways that we don't even know. There's something called micronutrition. That small things that we see that we're discovering and trace elements that are in food that actually provide healing to the cells. There are things like zinc, and there's things like B6, and these immune modulators that affect the way the brain actually works. And these things come from the soil and from live active food. So the food that you eat is really your medicine. Now, some people say, okay, don't eat any carbs because they want to lose weight. Well, I promoted the keto diet for a while in my country, in my practice. I don't promote the keto diet anymore. It will last for a short time, and then it can have other effects on the body, increase in cortisol and stress because of the fact that your body does need carbs. Whole foods, that is carbs, fats, and proteins. But plant-based. Some people say, well, I want protein. I got to get it from meat. No, there are many wonderful sources of protein that are plant-based, like beans. Of course, plant fiber-rich meals. Eat more raw fruits and vegetables. Don't just get the package of fruit from the box or from the can with all that sugar in it. I remember seeing a lady brought her kid and said, well, you know, I've got him some fruit, Dr. James. I said, okay, what type of fruit? Well, you know, fruit loops. I said, no, you you can't. Don't worry about that. Don't worry about fruit loops. There's fruit in it. Some fruit in it. There's fruit in it. I said, well, that's not exactly what we're talking about. The marketing strategies have been so effective, and they just exploit our ignorance. You want to eat raw fruit and raw vegetables. What did I say? Raw fruit and raw vegetables. It's going to take a little bit of adjusting to, but the body begins to get healing just from eating raw food. The less cooked it is, the more it has life in it. And the things that scientists don't know that nature has hidden in it that's redemptive, restorative, and healing. Spirit of prophecy is very clear about this, that the foods that Daniel ate affected the clarity of his mind and influenced his moral perception. Focus on beans, whole grains, and legumes. Enjoy nuts, olives, avocados, and olive oil. And finally, rest. You know, we push our bodies so hard, but the body will break down. Don't abuse yourself. You're the only you that you have. I remember seeing a man who was very, very wealthy, and he had a lot of houses, a lot of land, that he had poor health. And he said he'll give away his house, his dogs, his land, and his money, and live in a small dog box if he could just be independent, walking, and in his right mind. Health is wealth. Running your body down to get more money makes you poorer, not richer. I know what you're thinking, but I need to make my ends meet. I think you need to put the laws of God into effect and ask God to bless you as you try to be a good steward of his temple. I want you to step out in a place called faith. And if you rest in the promises of Jesus and keep his laws, he opens a way that you don't know of. You say, but I can't afford. No, no, no. What you cannot afford to do is destroy the very temple that God lives in. Because if you're not resting, you're not going to make good decisions. And if depression clouds your judgment, you're going to see God as an enemy, see yourself as less than valuable, and it can have eternal consequences. Establish a regular sleep routine. A what? Yeah, you should say, I'm going to go to bed at 10 o'clock. 9:30, I'm winding down. But I've got to study. I've got to, you have a choice. For some reason, you feel it's okay to abuse your body. I've got good news for you. Your body will pay you back if you treat it well. You will do better at work, better in school, if you had regular sleep times. And it helps lessen the sleep challenges associated with depression in particular. Daily sunshine and exercise. We know about vitamin D, but there are many other things about the sun that produces. Not just the sun comes into the body and takes precursors of vitamin D, uses a wave to change it to active form of vitamin D, and therefore the vitamin D is responsible for influencing mood. That's one of the things that sunlight does. But the other things, there are other waves that sunlight has that affects the eyelids, that affects the mood, and affects the circadian rhythm. And that produces things like melatonin, and also impacts upon serotonin production, which ultimately helps you fight against depression. So sunlight is something you don't want to avoid. It's something you want to get more of. We know that people that live in communities that do not have much sunlight have a higher incidence of depression. We thought that it was only because of the fact they didn't have enough vitamin D. No, vitamin D was one of the confounders that contributed to depression, but there are other things that sunlight does that we don't even know much about, and that helps to fight off depression. Increasing sunlight decreases depression. Exercise. You know, you don't have to do vigorous exercise. The fact is that moderate exercise actually is better than vigorous exercise. People think they have to go to weights and lift and become, no, just moderate exercise. If you go walking 1 hour a day, 4 to 5 days a week. Some resistance exercise is very good. Mild weightlifting, because you want to use the large muscle groups. Once you stimulate the large muscle groups, they release growth factors that affect the whole body and also can affect the mood. So resistance exercise is very helpful, very important. Some people think, should I run a marathon? You don't need to. Just moderate walking that uses large muscle groups. Resistance exercises, whether it be push-ups, sit-ups, pull-ups, chin-ups, but doing them regularly will help your body relax and improve your mood. Don't eat late. Is anybody here that eats late? If you eat late, say, I eat late. Or if you're online, if you eat late, say, I eat late. Sometimes confession is good for them. Let me hear you say, I eat late. Yeah, you know you eat late. I eat late too, but I've stopped eating late because I've discovered when you eat late, it affects your mood. You don't rest well when the blood is trying to digest food, when it's trying to also help you get a better mood. And then you've got releasing of things that affect sugar. And so the system is overcharged. Don't eat late. If you're going to go to bed at 10, you want to finish your food considerably hours before that. Avoid caffeine and alcohol. Caffeine, when I was in medical school, I remember they had these things called no-dos. And this girl came in and said, how are you making out? I was tired. She said, why don't you try these? I said, what's that? It's called no-dos. Everybody takes it. No-dos, okay. And I took that no-dos, and I didn't doze for quite a while. My brain was bing, 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 bing. And when I took the exam, I couldn't understand what I was reading because I was no-dosed. You know, your brain has to get used to that thing. That stimulation of a long period of time actually can cause disruption in the brain, and it affects your mood in the long term. Alcohol is another major thing that's implicated in affecting mood and causing depression. It's very much commonly used. And many people use it to just take the edge off when they want to go out for social anxiety issues. But the long-term use of alcohol has been known to cause increase in depression. Develop a sleep routine. I know it's hard, because when you get home, you get home, and you get home. When you get home, you get home, and you get home, because you're running. No, you can't just get home and you get home. Sleep is a priority. You have to say, I'm going to go to bed at this time, which means you have to get home at a certain time and prepare for the next day. Your life must become more regular. And the more organized and predictable your life is, the less stress you have. Leave media alone at night. And that's when everybody wants to watch media. Anybody here watch the media at night? Especially the news. Turn it off. You can't change it anyway. But you're watching. And you're getting more and more and more hyped up on news that you can't. Prophecy is more reliable than the news. Prophecy tells you what's going to happen before the news even finds out. Oh, y'all ain't listening to what I'm saying. And not only that, but prophecy offers hope. News always offers despair and doom. They make money off of your fear. God wants you to get yourself advanced off of your faith. Prophecy builds faith. News builds fear. Prophecy is free. News costs you something. It costs you peace of mind. Get the facts and then go to prophecy. Then go to the Psalms. Then go to the Proverbs. Then find some promises. Because you're going to need Proverbs, promises, Psalms, and prophecy, all P's, to fight off that poison that comes from the news. Because the news wants you to have a perspective of anxiety and depression, and you become addicted, and you become paralyzed, and you feel defeated, and you walk around angry because you've got something in your brain that's affecting your feelings, but it's not corresponding with the facts. The facts is not what's happening right now, but what's happening right here. The big fact is what's happening up there. The news you need to know is that in 1844, a judgment began in heaven. What judgment? Well, Adam, who was depressed and felt that he was naked and ashamed and felt condemned, he had a judgment against him. And that judgment would be projected and protected all the way to 1844 when the judgment that Adam felt really is put into place. And that judgment that Adam felt, condemnation, you and I feel all day long. But the good news is that the judgment was in favor of the saints. In other words, in the judgment since 1844, Jesus Christ is telling the unfallen world that Adam is not guilty. Adam is declared righteous. You didn't hear me. In the investigative judgment that Adam expected, this is the news that you need to know, is that Jesus is declaring those who are trusting him as righteous and those who don't trust him as unrighteous. The good news is that Jesus right now is preparing a place for you. The good news is he's your advocate, a public defender, looking for people who've got the worst record in life, looking for people who've made the most mistakes, so he can take your record and put it on his record, take his record and put it on your record. Now, that should be on every news channel every night. Somebody ought to say amen. If the gleaner wants to say anything, tell them what Jesus is doing right now to declare righteous anyone who's willing to turn their life over and trust him and start trying him. That's what's happening right now. That is present truth. That is current news. Not that you're going to die and we're going to starve. There's going to be no food and the cryptocurrency is going down. They're going to take away your money. And before you know, where should I invest my money? You're all over the place. Look at what you do know. The fact is what prophecy says. And make sense with that, and then go to have a good night's sleep. Exercise lights a fire on every level of your brain, from stoking up the neurons, metabolic forces, to forging the structures that transmit information between the cells. In other words, you have one cell and another cell talking. Exercise increases the ability for them to communicate. Exercise is not an instant cure, but you need to get your brain working again. And if you move your body, your brain won't have any choice other than to kick into gear. I would go to the Emancipation Park, a sacred ground, and I was so excited to see so many people walking in the morning. Just walking. So many people out there walking. They're getting their brain in gear. It's a process that the best strategy is to take it one step and then one stride at a time. At its core, depression is defined as an absence of moving toward anything. And exercise is a way to divert those negative signals and trick the brain into coming out of hibernation. So the brain is kind of hiding. You exercise, you kick it, and it challenges it to come forward. So you need help? Just put your hand up. I'm struggling. Find help. You need support? Connect with somebody that cares about you, and there are many people who care. You need advice? Find credible resources that you can go to and get advice. What should I be eating? How should I be sleeping? What things are going on in my spiritual life right now that may be affecting my guilt? You know, that some of our theology, I'm going to spend a little time here. Some of us have come into, been baptized into fear. Oh, this is present truth, and you have to know that, you know, you, right now God wants you to afflict yourself, and you must beat yourself down and abase yourself so that God can like you. You know, if you have this one, if you have that one, you know, you may not make it into the 144,000. You're not going to be translated because you're not eating, because you're eating meat. You made that mistake. I saw you have a moral failure, and, you know, I don't know if God can accept you the way you are. So much condemnation because of bad theology. And many people built a life and made a big church, came into existence, as a matter of fact, that was actually made money off of this. It was a church that showed up in 325 that took the pure Christian message that says you're saved by faith in grace and grace alone. That's good mental health. Somebody ought to say amen. That you're saved by faith in the grace of God and that alone. As a matter of fact, that where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. In other words, God is not just going to cover you, but if you're a sinner, he's also going to cleanse you with that grace. You can't fix yourself, so Jesus decided to get into your situation, take off his jacket and put it on you, take your jacket and put it on him, let you go free while he took a price, paid a price for you. Where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. You don't do anything to be saved except for seek him, and surrender, and he does the rest. But many people have been taught that you have to do something so that God can like you. You got to somehow get God's approval. You don't have to get God's approval. Jesus got God's approval for you. You don't have to get God's approval. Jesus got God's approval for you. Your faith is in Christ's righteousness, not yours. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. I said your confidence is in his righteousness, not yours. Now, obedience is a standard of Christian living, because now that you know that you are declared righteous, he's going to give you the power to actually live a righteous life, because unrighteous life simply breeds more condemnation and more depression. So why would you want to do something that's going to make you depressed again? So Christ says, I'm going to give you not just covering, but I'm also give you cleansing so you don't get condemned again. So the reason why you want to live a life of obedience is so that you don't get the headache that Adam had. Not so that you can make it into heaven. No, Christ did that. But so that you can get heaven to come inside of you. Somebody should say amen right there. It is by faith in grace and that alone. But the Christian church was corrupted with the view that you've got to drink wine, you've got to eat bread, you've got to please the Pope. And they blocked out that daily sanctuary service that promises faith and grace and turned your mind to looking at a condemnation and eternal burning hell. And for hundreds of years throughout Europe, around the world, people were in a great dark depression because of religion and toxic theology. And though the Protestant Revolution came and they said, no, here comes a bright light, a solo gratia, grace, solo fide, solo faith, and solo logos, just the Bible, the Word of God, faith and grace alone. We slip back into thinking, okay, I'm depressed again. Maybe if I've got to do this, keep the Sabbath and faith and grace. No, no, no. You're saved by faith in the grace of God and that alone. Now that you're saved, you have the power to obey so that you don't go back into condemnation. So you choose his will, and he gives you the power to protect you from falling into depression. You don't want to get condemned again, so you need help, because you can't change yourself, but you can choose His will, and he gives you the power to fulfill it so that you don't wind back up in condemnation and being cursed again. Somebody ought to say amen. So the law is important. It's the standard of Christian living. It preserves and it protects. Though it doesn't save, it keeps you safe. So you need to have good guidance in good theology. Habits of thinking and outlook. To a large extent, we have the ability to choose. We have the ability to do what? How we will think about a situation. You don't have to be a slave to your emotions. You don't have to be a slave to your feelings. You actually have the power to what? Choose. You can go back to that cognitive distortion and say, that lady walked past me, and who does she think she is? She's got a nursing degree. Or you can say, you know, let me go and greet her because she may have a problem herself. You can actually love your enemy because it's too dangerous keeping them as an enemy because that person may need you more than you need them. You can actually bless those that curse you because when you bless them, the blessing comes back on you. You can actually do good to those who do evil against you because by doing that, you reverse the curse. As long as you don't like a bad-minded person, you become the bad-minded person that they don't like you. Your seeds of thoughts produce fruit, and they have deep roots that entangle and strangle you. So you can choose to act positively and not react negatively. Love the person that does things evil to you. Speak good of the one who says bad things about you. Pray for them, people that try to hurt you. Because by doing it, you heap coals of fire on their head, but you protect yourself from the coals of fire that comes on your head. Check those negative thoughts. Focus on solutions rather than problems. You hear some people, they always rehearse the problem. It's the same problem. They may need to exercise, get nutrition, but they need to start changing their thoughts. Help them to say, okay, what are you going to do about it? Here are some possible solutions. And once they start the practice, the body begins to think, oh yeah, let me look for solutions. Just need to get into the habit of it. What you magnify will get bigger. And I've been here. Worry, bitterness, stress. You ruminate over it, and before you know it, it becomes much bigger than it really is. And all of us have this possibility. The solution is trust, find the solution, and have faith. Sometimes you need to turn it over to Jesus. You didn't hear me. You can't figure it all out. Science will not agree with this. Because science doesn't believe in faith. That's why you got to know its limitations. Like faith needs to know its limitations. But when you come to the end of the evidence, you need to step into the world of faith on the word. There may not be evidence in science, but I see some evidence in the word of God. You can simply say, it is written. That's more real than it was in a test tube. Yeah. The word of God is more sure foundation to base your faith than what a scientist came up with because, you know, they change. They're trying to get there, and we respect that. But when the word of God, it doesn't change. Jesus, when he was tempted in the wilderness, he just simply said, it is written. Step out on the word of God. Don't follow your feelings. Study the facts. And the word of God will open up a pathway upon which you build your faith. Spiritual need. And this is important. We live in a culture and a time when you can't talk about spirituality. And it's a time when there's more prevailing depression, more prevailing anxiety, more prevailing self-doubt than ever. This is a time when we need to find the solid word. Now, not every preacher is teaching the word. So, again, just like you can't follow the scientists, you got to follow the science. Don't follow the preacher. You got to follow the word. One of the biggest things we found out with the pandemic was we don't know how to read the science. It's too much. We had to trust somebody to tell us. Well, those days are gone when it comes to the Bible because we can read the Bible. Here a little, there a little. And we have supporting resources, the pen of inspiration, the spirit of prophecy, which illuminates and sheds light on the greater light if you have questions. And then when you're in the body of Christ with those true faithful believers that believe, you should read the Bible as it says. Don't let some higher criticism change things. It's going to say it the way it means it. And you corroborate, because there's 66 different peer-reviewed journals, 66 different books with 39 different authors, and they don't conflict. So if this one doesn't say it, this one is saying it, this one is saying it, and if you read it over a period of time, you begin to understand, I can have faith in the Word of God. You ought to start trying it, church. Even when you can't see it, step out on faith because it says it. Say it again. Even when you can't see it, step out on faith because it says it. And I'm going to guarantee you this. When you can't even see his hand, you can trust his heart. Because Jesus is going to make a way just for you. Even if it means stepping out of a boat, walking on water in the midst of a storm. Somebody in here today has been in storms before. You had no option but to get out of that boat in a situation you were. And there was no pavement, yet God made a highway out of no way. Somebody ought to say amen. Trust him when you can't trace him. Because he's making a way just for you. He took me out of a deep waste place, out of the soft and sticky earth. He put my feet on rock and made my steps certain. Look at that. He took me out of a deep waste place. Haven't you been in a waste place sometime in your life? Haven't you been in a situation where people wrote you off? Out of a soft and sticky earth, that's mud where he couldn't climb his way out. He was trying to climb his way up, but it was soft and sticky. But the text says, he took me out. That's an active process, not a passive process. I couldn't climb out. He reached in and he took me out. That means I couldn't help myself, but somebody took hold of me, took me out of a rocky, sticky place and placed my feet, what? On ground, on a rock, and made my steps certain. You got to remember where God has led you in the past if you're going to know where he's going to lead you in the future. Healing takes place with time and perseverance. Today's choices yield tomorrow's gifts. I want you to know today, you're planting seeds, not for now, you're planting seeds for eternity. You don't want to do things, plant a seed and have to reap a harvest later. I had a text message from someone today, and in his youth, he planted seeds. And I felt sorry for him. Had this woman, this girl, smoked weed, never kept a job, was very popular, but he doesn't have character. You get out what you put in. And though people may see you and wave, you've got to deal with your garden alone. You ought to find a pathway to success. I got 66 books, 39 different authors, written over 6,000 years record. And it's a way out of no way that it seems like a hard way. But it's the right way. It's got two principles. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be what? Happy in Jesus than to what? Trust and obey. Some people struggle with the trust part. And you feel you're going to do it on your own. You're going to try to obey. You're going to have a breakdown. Other people have an obey part. Well, I believe, I trust. But you have to step out of the boat. So it starts with a complete, I'm going to choose to surrender, trust him. And then I'm going to choose his way and not my way. And I'm going to tell you, he's going to open up a Red Sea. He's going to take you across an ocean. And he's going to put your foot on solid ground. Healing takes place in time and perseverance. Today's choices yield tomorrow's gifts. Healing brain, body, systems that are stuck in a rut. He put a new song in my mouth. A song of praise to our God. I want you to know, friends, today, God can turn your situation around. Number one, nutrition. plant-based, what type of nutrition? What's another thing we can do besides nutrition? Exercise. Somebody else, what's another thing we can do besides exercise? Sunlight. What's another thing we can do besides sunlight? Somebody said proper rest. What's another thing we can do? Change your thinking habits. Somebody else, what's another thing we can do? Water. I didn't say water, but yes, water is another very important thing because the brain is made up more than 90% water. So we said water, there's exercise, there's nutrition, change your thinking habit. What else? Sunshine. Somebody said sunshine. More than just vitamin D, there are other rays that actually affect the brain. What else can we do? Trust and obey. Don't just trust, you must also obey. And was there anything, did we miss anything? Television. Turn it off. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, she's made a very good point. Ask for help. It's not a weakness. It's a strength. Ask for help. Go to your doctor. Go to a counselor. Go to a pastor. I'm having this. I need help. And I want you to know, God will guide you to the right people. And remember, you are a spiritual creature and God is on your side. Have faith, he's not against you. Go with the facts and not your feelings. Because the facts are in the Word of God. And the feelings will catch up in due time. Put your hands together and give God some praise. Do we have any questions? We have 5 minutes. Any questions that anyone wants to ask about this session tonight? Anybody, a question or remark? Comment or question? Anyone? Okay, Brother Nugent. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Pastor said that he forgot to tell us that it's his birthday today. It is his birthday. So let's do a quick happy birthday. I'm sure he got it earlier today, but we're just going to sing happy birthday to Pastor.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Amen, amen. And so we're going to sing our theme song, I Bless Your Name. You can sit and sing from where you are.
In prisoner's chains, with bleeding stripes, fallen silent. Chains were loose and they were free. They sang,
I bless your name.
changes, and that during menopause